Good morning, everybody. It's 9:22 a.m. I want to spend some time with you really quickly. Hey, Bria, good to see you. Pastor Jamal, I see you in here. Bonafide, I see you in here. Pastor Rhonda Allison, I see you in here. Germaine, I think I see you. Hello from Texas. Jasmine Benson, I see you. Vicky, I see you. Pastor Jamal, I see you. Pam Ross, I see you. Hey, Raven, I see you. Crystal in Christ, I see you. Spin with it. Hey, how you doing? Good morning, Vicky. 100% Hutch, how are you? Good morning. I think this is Rob Perkins. Trap Grayson. Pam Ross, I love you so dearly. Marshawn 2020. Last night was awesome. Right. Part of what I'm going to deal with you about today. First of all, let me say good morning to all of you. I hope that all of you are doing really, really, really well. I committed to my church that I would do 7 days of spiritual warfare. And last night I led intercessory prayer at my church, and I gave them a teaching on prayer weapons. And I established the fact that God identifies himself as a man of war, that he has war tactics, that he has war weapons. If you have not read that or seen that, if somebody may have put it on YouTube, but it is still available. My Periscope, I think, is distorted on my Periscope. So you can go to John John's Periscope, or Pastor Jamal, I think, may have it. A couple of others may have it, or see if it's been uploaded to YouTube. But last night, I led intercessory prayer at my church, and I also made a fresh commitment to do that once a month. It is a very, very, very strong burden of mine to be, to lead the way in effective intercession and lead the way and what prayer looks like in the life of the local church. You have often heard me say that I think it's irresponsible for leaders to delegate the responsibility of establishing their prayer life to a mother's board or somebody else. Everything cannot be delegated. You are not just the gubernatorial and the governmental head of that house. You are also the spiritual head of that house, which means that you need to take responsibility with leading it in prayer. And so I did it last night, and I taught, and then we prayed, and I relayed a foundation on warfare last night, and I relayed a foundation of directing your prayers the right way. One of the things we talked about was war moves. And Nehemiah 4, 1 through 18 identifies what a war move is. A war move is anything that is progressive, okay? You got to realize that hell hates all progress. Hell hates all prosperity. Please see that. And if hell uses prosperity, it's only to increase one in wickedness. So please realize that if you've made a decision to come out of a wrong relationship, to leave an occultic organization or bad church, to break up with a lover that you didn't need to be with, to come out of a demonic habit, if you've made any substantial barrier-breaking progress, then you have signed up for war. Not bad, but here's a challenge. I told my church yesterday that there's a lot of people who are fighting and they don't know how to fight. It is akin to being somebody that enjoys watching wrestling, as I do, and enjoy watching boxing, as I do, and enjoy watching UFC, as I do, and thinking that because they've seen it enough, they can do it. Although I am an avid wrestling fan, I'm an avid boxing fan, I see you, Bonafide. I'm an avid ECW UFC fan. I dare not step in the ring because I wasn't trained to do what I watched them do. And I think the same is true with spiritual warfare. I think we have learned prayer by observation. We've looked around to see how Big Mama did it, how Deacon Jones did it, how people on TV did it, whoever our prayer consultant, expert people do it. And we kind of just do it because they did it, and we don't review the scriptures about how it should be done. And one of the things that I laid last night was that there are weapons in the scriptures. And you can see that, all right? So I've dedicated to Periscope to give 7 days of war and 7 days of spiritual warfare. And I'm going to give you war periscopes, and then I'm going to pray for you. And then that's going to be it, okay? Last night we learned some very powerful things about spiritual warfare and why it's necessary, what it is and what it is not. One of the most controversial things that we learned last night, that spiritual warfare is not praying to Satan. And sometimes when you see people who are strong in spiritual warfare, what they do is they call God, they ask him to hold the phone, and then for the next 40 minutes, they start a conversation with their adversary. So it's like, Father, we thank you. We love you. Thank you for forgiving me. And I say, and I bind you. I plead the blood against you. I arrest you. You won't harass me. The blood loose you. The blood. So it's almost like God becomes the operator to facilitate your conversation with hell. Why do you pray to talk to hell? And I think that's because we've developed a type of prayer that prays the problems and not prays the answers. Now, I do believe that things can be said out of you to Satan, but I don't think that you should allow an entire conversation with your adversary to be had while God is on hold. There is a way to vocally, biblically bind the powers of darkness with what you say, but that certainly should not be 90% of your prayer life if you're going to call that spiritual warfare, because then you're not praying. You're just talking to the devil, and that's not prayer. We also learned that demons need a body to facilitate their agenda. And so we learned last night that spiritual warfare is not praying against people. It's praying against the spirits, the forces that they partner with. Bodies are temples. Paul told us, know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. So before you get filled with the Holy Ghost, before you get saved, it doesn't mean that your body is not a temple. It's still a temple. What it does is it actually becomes the workplace for the gods that you serve and the gods that you have allegiance to. So our enemy is never going to be flesh and blood. It's always going to be the powers that operate through flesh and blood. So that's important. Every demonic spirit has a task force, an administration team, an agenda, a planning squad that works out and that physicalizes their intent. And so that's very, very, very important for you to realize. People are not your problem. Now, you can bind what's operating in them. You can restrict what's operating in them. You can release the blood to frustrate, confuse what's operating in them. You can lose hysteria, panic, madness, insanity, and let the plans of the wicked be frustrated. But you got to realize that all men were born for worship, no matter where they are. You know, you were created in the garden. The human species was created with worship intrinsically in it, okay? And so because you were born and created for worship, salvation determines who. So you're going to worship all your life, but when you get saved, that determines who you're going to worship. If you're not saved, it doesn't mean you're not worshiping. It just means you're worshiping something else. And so all men are temples. This morning, I'm going to give you some insight really quickly. And you know, this is important to me because I'm grieved about how many people don't know how to fight and how many people are scared to fight and how many people are intimidated by the powers of darkness. So it's 9:30. I'm coming to you actually pre-gym time. So you know this is important to me. Thank you for inviting your followers, those of you that are. All right, this morning we're going to talk about the spirit of heaviness. The spirit of heaviness. In war, one of the things that you've got to be very careful of that you see very repetitively is that fear is the first response to an assassination, an accusation, an attempt, a threat, all of that. War, the byproduct of what they say, what they do, is a spirit of fear. And one of the fruit of the spirit of fear in your life is a spirit of heaviness, a spirit of heaviness. It's in the Bible. Matter of fact, let me give you those scriptures just so that you can refer to them, and then I'm going to give you some insight, and then I'm going to pray for you. But the Bible talks about the spirit of heaviness, and it talks about taking on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. That's Isaiah 61 and 3. So it calls heaviness a spirit, okay? It says, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. That's Isaiah 61 and 3. So there is a such thing as a spirit that causes heaviness. And what that is it's basically the Bible description for depression. The Bible description for depression. Remember when Jezebel sent one statement against Elijah after all of the victories and all of the achievements and all of the ministerial and supernatural accomplishments that Elijah the prophet had. And Elijah and Jezebel sent word to him saying, see if I won't do the same to you this time tomorrow. Okay. And so she threatened him. She loosed a demonic threat. Now you can have threats in your heart, threats in your mind. We learned yesterday that warfare hits three areas. It's going to hit your heart, your mind, and your strength. Those are the three primary areas of a demonic attack: your heart, your mind, your strength. But what happened to Elijah? Elijah responded to the assault, the accusation, the threat of Jezebel, and he went in heaviness under a juniper tree. After being on the Mount of Carmel, he now found safety under a tree. Think about that. There are people around the world that know what it is to live on the top of mountains, that have seen the top of things. And then if the devil hits the right thing, says the right thing, threatens them in the right way, or hits the right heartstring, they'll leave the mountain and go to a tree. And Elijah found himself under a tree. And that spirit of heaviness, when you don't check it, it turns into the spirit of death. Death is a graduated form of the spirit of heaviness. When Elijah was under the juniper tree and he was depressed, after a while he said, I wished and I prayed of myself that I would die. So a spirit of suicide, a spirit of grief, a spirit of death. If you allow depression to linger, it's going to graduate into a desire to die. Okay? If you don't check the spirit of heaviness, it's going to graduate into a desire to die. Depression is an extremely common phenomena with leaders, with musicians, with churches, in prophetic individuals, it's true, in revelatory individuals, it's true, a spirit of depression. And depression manifests in a lot of different ways for a lot of different people. For some, believe it or not, it can come, it can manifest in anger, it can manifest in rage, it can manifest through lust, it can manifest through isolation, it can manifest through alienation, it can manifest with a desire to leave, and through fantasy, to leave your body. And so these are things we need to do, that we need to deal with. Now, I used to live with this spirit, so I know it very well. But the challenge is because nobody ever confronted it, no word, no truth, no leader ever saw it, I thought it was a part of my personality. You call it high highs and you call it low lows. No, that's abnormal, because what it means is that you have mastered two minds. And the Bible says that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So if you are one of them people that has said over yourself, I have high highs and low lows, what you're saying is that you know what it is like Elijah to be on the mountain and then to run to a tree. If you have the wrong thought, if the wrong person does the wrong thing, if Jezebel sends a threat at you, high highs and low lows is code for schizophrenia, but is also the fruit of a spirit of heaviness. A spirit of heaviness. So this morning in our war scope, we are addressing the spirit of depression. It is a spirit, and you will be free from it once you learn how to identify it as such. Now, let me give you something else. I am an avid supporter of mental health. I know what demons do to chemicals. Some people go into the argument of whether or not you should get counseling for depression, whether you should medicate it, or whether you should fight it. I think depending upon the case, you should fight it in the spirit. And I think for some people, depending upon how strong it is, I think it's okay to take meds. Here's the problem. You know, you people will take an aspirin for a headache, but won't take a pill. And medicines come from God, some of them, to adjust and align your chemicals to make sure you're thinking straight. If you're at the point of being a clinical depressive case, where you are in the bed every day, don't want to do nothing, and you don't even want anybody to pray, then maybe beyond the deliverance session, you need a doctor or some pills. And I know the African-American church, that's discouraged, but I think that if you will take an aspirin, if you will take a fever, if you will take Novocaine for a toothache, your brain is a muscle. It may need to be realigned. Now, do I think it's a devil? Yes. But I know one of the things about devils is that they are also chemists. They study the human nature. How else do you think sickness comes from the devil? You see, when you deal with a spirit of infirmity, they are scientifically astute. They know how to work your chemical order against you. So you're not dealing with dumb devils, and sometimes it may need medical agents to help align what a demon has done. So I don't ever get into the argument of whether or not it's a demon or whether it's a disease. I think if it's a disease, it's there because of a devil, and you can address the devil and address the disease. The book of Revelation talk about the healing of the nations being in the tree of life. So I think there are certain ways to cure certain things. Now, I want to pray for those of you that wrestle with the spirit of heaviness. As I said, being a prophetic person, I dealt with this. It almost took me out in the year 2001. I was medicated. I overdosed, actually, on a steroid, and I was supposed to die. One of the many times I was supposed to die. And I was actually put in a rubber jacket, in a rubber room, and I was kept there because of a desire to die. There was a time in my life where death looked more appealing than life itself, and I overdosed. And when I tried to overdose, the spirit of heaviness came in my life. It was a spirit of heaviness, so God delivered me from that event. But that spirit of depression would come back and back and back. So I know depression very, very, very well. And so I hate it with a perfect hatred. I understand how it attacks people. I understand what it does to people's courage. I understand what people what it does to people's logic, what it does to people's insight. So this morning, the first thing that we're going to attack in these 7 days of war is the spirit of heaviness, that there are more in you and there are more for you than there is against you, and that there is nothing that Satan can do, say, or attempt that has the authority over your destiny. David says, when the wicked, my enemies and my foes, if they come upon me to eat my flesh, they stumble and fail. And this morning, we're going to pray to lose stumbling and slippery steps and blindness upon those that want to be used to conspire against you, to approach you and devour your life and devour your journey and devour where you're going, that they stumble in their attempts against you, and that the conspiracy of the wicked be frustrated. So we've got to deal with the spirit of heaviness, because it's going to get in the way of your vision. It's going to get in the way of your drive, your stamina, your strength, your courage, your identity even, okay? So that's what we're attacking this morning, is the spirit of heaviness, okay? Now let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for everybody watching me this morning on Periscope, and I give you glory for their lives. I thank you for their salvation. I thank you for their redemption. I thank you that they have been written and numbered with the saints, that their names have been written in the Lamb's book of life, and they belong to you, that you have died for them, and you have raised them up within you, and you have seated them in heavenly places in God. I give you glory for their journey, for their history, for their story. I give you glory for their decisions to be turned towards your direction. And now in the name of Jesus, I ask you for release, even of the peace of God, which passes all understanding. Let there be a release of the peace of God to guard their heart and guard their minds by Christ Jesus. And we forbid and we disallow and we restrict all demonic traffic and conversation in their soul. Let the forces of darkness be arrested, O God. Stand in the midst of them and raise a standard against the enemy. In the name of Jesus, let the spirit of heaviness that has assigned itself to their emotions, the spirit of heaviness that has assigned itself to their courage, to their focus, to their concentration, be arrested. We serve you notice today that you are under arrest. The blood confuse you, the blood drown you, and the blood shut up your way. We command gag orders upon the forces of darkness that would talk and release their threats and their murmurings against them, even from the forces of fear and the forces of terror and torment. In the name of Jesus, we loose and we apply the blood of Jesus to every entry point and every access point to their life now, and we loose the fiery wrath of Jehovah Gabor, Jehovah Sabaoth upon the fiery darts of the devil that want to attack and pierce their hearts and pierce their souls in Jesus' name. I command their lives to be reinforced. I command their lives to be established. I command their peace to be secure. Let there be barbed wire fences of the word of God and of the principles of the spirit around their lives and around their hearts in the name of Jesus. And there will be no intrusion and no invasion to them, that they are secure, that you are the rock that is higher than they, and that they find themselves hidden in the rock in Jesus' name. May the lights be turned off and the forces of darkness that want to pursue them with terror and torment be turned off, and let them grope like blind men and stumble upon themselves. In the name of Jesus, the Son of God, we command their destinies to be secured, their assignments to be protected. We pray for their homes, their sons, their daughters, their wives. We pray for their households in the name of Jesus Christ, that this is a season of progress that will not be penetrated and it will not be permeated in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the kingdom of God stand against the forces of hell that want to pull down their work and pull down their progress and pull down their prosperity in the name of Jesus, the man of war. We release the arrows of the mouth of God to begin to be loose with fiery wrath and vengeance. Let his hysteria come upon us, every generational curse. Let madness and insanity come upon those that plot and conspire against them, to try to plan against them in Jesus' name and plot against them. May the teeth of the wicked be broken this morning in Jesus' name, and may no conversation, let nothing come nigh their dwelling. Any rumor, any scandal, any gossip, any malice, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, all jealousy, all envy and strife that's aimed on them to make them think twice against who they are in you, in the name of Jesus, we silence them, we muzzle their mouths in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we release the peace of God, the weapon of the word of God, to bring peace to the lives and the souls of those that are the saints. In the name of Jesus, we bind the spirit of fantasy this morning. We come against all escapism that comes with the spirit of heaviness that allows them to remove themselves from their lives and to create alternate realities and alternate worlds to medicate them from the power and the pressures of heaviness. We bind fantasy in the name of Jesus. We come against lust in the name of Jesus. We bind the spirits of porn and fornication that would try to make them find welcome and find comfort in the arms of the flesh, and we release supernatural strength to remain holy and righteous in the name of Jesus. You will not be turned over to the devices of the wicked because of heaviness, but you will find strength in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, this morning that you are our shield. Be a shield for us in the name of Jesus, and a buckler, and resist the fiery darts of hell that are aimed against our peace and aimed against our victory. We decree this morning that we are free, and we loose ourselves from the spirit of heaviness and from the curse of depression in the name of Jesus, and we align our emotions with the truth of the word of God. We align our emotions and our thinking with the power of the word of God. We align our emotions and our feelings, and we command them to submit to Jesus Christ. Be established, O God, as God of our lives, as God of our hearts, as God of our emotions, as God of our thinkings. You are God over us. You are God over this day, and there is not another beside you. We release ourselves from the control of the spirit of depression, from that octopus that wants to have their tentacles around our mind, switching our thoughts based upon what's going on in the day. We release this, we acknowledge and we announce the sovereignty of God over our thought patterns and our thought lives, and we say that our strength is not abated and our eyes are clear because of the victory in the blood of Jesus. We command victory to this day and victory to the rest of our achievements and our plans in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, and we declare that depression is defeated, that heaviness is burned down, that the bridges that release that in our lives are brought down, and that we are found safe and victorious and delivered and healed and whole and redeemed and focused and reinforced and upheld by the mighty right hand of the Lord Jesus Christ. We decree that done today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. God bless each of you. I will be praying for you every day, come what may, for 7 days, and I will be teaching you war. Whatever you do, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Fear is a paralysis agent, which is one of the byproducts of a spirit of heaviness, which is that you cannot move. So we are going into a new level of protection over all of the progress that we're making. Nehemiah 4:18, I want you to read it, talks about how they had a building tool in one hand and a war weapon in the other hand. So we're not just going to build and grind and hustle and move. We're going to build, grind, hustle and move and break and plunder and devour and destroy and consume and blast and arrest and restrict and forbid. Be it. So we're going to have an equal balance of our progress, and we're going to protect our progress by the power of the Holy Ghost. I love you guys. I hope that you're doing very well today. I will see you this afternoon. Be victorious today in Jesus' name. And no matter what emails you get, what bad news you get, what threats, what attempts you get, you can handle it in the spirit. All right. So I love you guys. Be released from heaviness and enjoy your day. All right. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.